Praise the Lord. I welcome everyone to our workers training tonight in Jesus' name. All our workers in Lagos, all our workers all over the states in Nigeria and all over Africa and beyond, I welcome everyone in Jesus' name. This year, workers training is starting from Oyo State. And we're so happy because of the conditions here that makes it very easy. And we're flowing into great blessings this year in Jesus' name. And the blessings of the new year will multiply in every life. And as we are here today, alive in Christ, alive in the promises of God, all the promises of God, everything we reach in the world will be yes and amen in every life in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for this hour. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you because you bless your people. And we're asking, Lord, that from this very day, you prepare your people for greater ministry, happy ministry, joyful ministry, fruitful ministry, purposeful ministry in Jesus' name. And we're asking, Lord, that you will so bless your people, the blessings will overflow to all our neighbors in Jesus' name. And we're praying that your power will work in an irresistible way. As your people go out, as they touch other people's lives, blessings will flow from heaven through them into people around us in Jesus' name. Wake up your church. Alert your church. Let your church be on fire for you. I will pray, Lord, you will do great and innumerable things through every life, boys and girls and youth, young people, campus people, men and women, leaders, workers, every one of us in Jesus' name. We'll see new things this year, greater things this year, and greater impact upon every life this year in Jesus' name. Confirm the miracle upon every life. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. God bless you. You can sit down. We're coming to John chapter 1. And in John chapter 1, we're reading from verse 34. Please open your Bible. John chapter 1, verse 34. And I saw, here is John the Baptist talking. And he's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, and I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. In verse 35, it tells us again the next day after John stood and two of his disciples. And then in verse 36, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he says, behold the Lamb of God. You want to understand that John introduced everyone in his world. When I say in his world, everything connected, everyone connected with him. Whenever he saw anyone in his world, he connected them with the Son of God. He connected them with the Lamb of God. He told everyone in his world, everyone in the network of fellowship around him, he said, behold the Lamb of God. In verse 37, we're told, and the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. His ministration was effective. His declaration was effective. When he told them, behold the Lamb of God, two of the people around him immediately they rose up in answer to what he had said, and they followed Jesus. And then verse 38 tells us, and then Jesus turned and he saw them following and says unto them, what seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? Verse 39 tells us, and he says unto them, come and see. As we approach the Lord this year, and you want to dwell with him, you want to live with him, and you ask any question as to where are you, where do you live, and what do you do, what blessings are you going to give me, how are you going to use me, the Lord is going to tell you, come and see. You will see. Amen. You will see blessings this year. You'll see converts this year. You'll see power this year. And the Lord will talk to you directly. Come and see. We're coming to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 17. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, that's you, you are in Christ this year, you'll be fully in Christ. And all the blessings in Christ will be abundant in your life in Jesus' name. Therefore, if any man, any woman, if any child, if any boy or girl, and if any follower be in Christ, it's a new creature, new year, a new creature. A new creature, new blessing, a new power, a new anointing upon your life in Jesus' name. What you didn't see in the old year, in this new year, from today, you continue, you begin to see in Jesus' name. Old tears are wiped away. Old heartache, everything taken away. And any sickness of the old year will not follow you or into this new year in Jesus' name. New power, new authority, a new anointing. Everywhere you go, you'll find everything new. If any man be in Christ, it's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, tell me out loud, all things have become new. And now that you are in Christ and the new creature that you are now, look at verse 19. The ministry the Lord is giving you, it says to which in verse 19 that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, reconciling the world unto himself. I want you to picture the world as a big large circle, actually a globe, and then inside that circle you have small circles, and then where you are, there's a circle of relationship around you, a web of relationships around you. There are brothers, there are sisters, there is father, there is mother, there are students if you are a teacher, and there are pupils if you are the proprietor of a school. That's your world. It's a little circle there, and then you have all the people in your world. They are in that circle. I have people in my own circle, you have people in your own circle, and if I reach my world and you reach your world, all of us, all those little circles, we're going to reach the whole of the world. And the Lord has given you a ministry, he has given you a responsibility that you will reconcile your own world. I will reconcile my own world unto God through Jesus Christ. It says it's to reconcile the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and he has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. That's the word he has given you. He has not given you a word that will scatter people, a word that will repel people, a word that will bring poison or acid into any life. He'll make you a gatherer in Jesus' name. You will gather souls, you will attract souls, your life will be attractive, your tongue will be attractive, your disposition will be attractive, your action, everywhere you go, even your walking, people will look at you, and your life will attract others to Christ in Jesus' name. Reconciling your world to God through Christ. Look at verse 20. It says, now where now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ said, be ye reconciled unto God. We pray you, we plead with you, we're begging of you. There is one thing you are making sure in your relationship with people this year. They might talk about climate and talk about weather and talk about politics and talk about pandemic and talk about anything. You are waiting for them to finish. You are a good listener, but you are a good speaker as well. And as they finish speaking, there is one thing you are going to end up with. I'm pleading with you, be ye reconciled unto God. And then you give them the advantage, you give them the profit of being reconciled unto God. In that way, from this very month, the first month of the year, you are bringing souls into the kingdom. Amen. You will be fruitful this year. Amen. You will be progressive this year. And the Lord will put his word in your mouth. It will be a word of reconciliation. And whatever question people have, the Lord will give you the answer. He will give you the solution. You will attract people into the kingdom of God. Once again, the subject tonight is reconciling your world to God through Christ. We're looking at three things in the message. Number one, seeking the lost, one soul at a time. Seeking the lost, one soul at a time. You're going to hear about Andrew. He sought just one person at a time. Don't wait for a large crowd and don't wait for a great crusade. One by one, one soul at a time will win them to the Lord. Number two, sharing his love, one step at a time. His love is broad, his love is deep, his love is high. You cannot share everything in one moment, but to share the love of Christ with people at the point they are hurting, at the point they have any problem, and you are sharing that love one step at a time. Point number three, showing forth his life. Showing forth his life. What that means is, as you go through this year, you are not showing forth your own life. Your own life is limited, and your own life, you cannot speak for yourself, but you have Christ in you. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, it says, I will come in. When he comes into you, he brings all his grace, he brings all his goodness, he brings all his power, he brings all his knowledge, and he brings everything that Calvary has accomplished. When he says, I will come in unto him, I will sup with him, the Christ in you will not be an empty Christ. The Christ in you will not be a powerless Christ. The Christ in you will not be an ignorant Christ. He comes into you with all his characteristics and with all his nature and with all his power. And that is what you are showing for this year. This year, you'll not say, I will show you myself. Not for this year. This is a new year. You will not show anger. You will not show sorrow. You will not show depression. You will show the life of Christ as you contact people, as you connect with people this year, showing forth his life one statement at a time. One statement at a time. You will not so rush everything you are saying that people cannot even hear. You have said 100 things and we cannot understand anything you are saying. You are showing forth the life of Christ one statement at a time, and your words will have power. Your word will have authority, and you must believe that every time as you share with people. Let's look at number one there. Number one is seeking the lost, one soul at a time. Let's look at John chapter 1, reading from verse 40. John chapter 1, reading from verse 40. One of the two which had John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Then in verse 41, we're told he first findeth his own brother, Simon. That Simon was very close to him, his brother. He was a man in his own world, just like you have somebody in your own world, a brother, a sister, a father, a mother, somebody close to you, a friend, a neighbor, a co-tenant, then your world. And he first findeth his own brother. He made an effort. I have seen something good, I must show, I must share, I must partake with other people. He first findeth his own brother, only one soul, Simon, and saith unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. And then in verse 42, and he brought him to Jesus. It was persuasive. When you talk this year and you connect with people, either on phone, or you are connecting with people, you are sending a text, or you are connected with, you are connecting with people on your Facebook or your platform, you're doing something positive, and you are doing it persuasively, and you are bringing them, or you are contacting them on the street, or you are contacting them in your neighborhood. What you are doing, you will so do it that nobody will say no to you. Simon said yes to Andrew and your neighbors and your brothers and the people you have been speaking to in the past, and they said no. This year is a yes. Somebody give me a good yes. He brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is being interpreted a stone. We're looking at three things here. Number one is the compassion for a single soul. The compassion for a single soul. Number two, confidence in the spotless Savior. Confidence. Andrew was confident. If I take my brother Simon to Christ, Christ will not reject him. And you must have that same confidence as you bring people to Christ. Christ will not reject your friend, your neighbor, and the people in your circle of influence. Confidence in the spotless Savior. Number three, conversion into steadfast sonship. Let's look at number one there. Is the compassion for a single soul. You understand? Andrew was not over ambitious. He was taking one step at a time. And this year, if you have been, you want to take 10 steps altogether, why don't you slow down this year and understand that you bring a soul at a time. By the way, this single soul eventually brought 3,000 souls to Christ on the day of Pentecost. So don't minimize and don't belittle the value of that single soul you are bringing to the Lord. This is the single soul that told that lame man, silver and gold have I not, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. As a result of that healing, multitudes again came to the Lord. But you see, Andrew was not like that, like a miracle worker. He brought somebody higher than him, greater than him, more successful than him, more productive than him. He brought that one to Christ. That's why you should have compassion for a single soul. We've read it already in John chapter 1, verse 41. And we're looking at Mark chapter 1, verse 14. In Mark chapter 1, reading from verse 14. Here is also just one soul, we're told, and there came a leper to him, beseeching him and kneeling down to him and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Just one soul, just one person. And then we're told in verse 41, it says, and Jesus moved with compassion, the compassion he had, compassion for this one single soul. He didn't say, I'm too big for that, I'm a great, I'm the great savior, I came to save the whole world, and therefore I will not have compassion on one individual. In our lives, let's be with Christ, humble as Christ and meek as Christ and lowly as Christ. And if it is just one soul that you have in front of you, put everything you've got, all the knowledge you have, all the love you have, and approach people with a smile. Don't approach people with frown. Don't connect frowning with holiness. And don't connect, you know, being kind of bitter, and you're going through life and you're pounding them on the head. Let compassion show in your attitude, in your relationship with people, and let there be love for one single soul. And then we're told that Jesus was moved with compassion, and he put forth his hand and he touched him. He touched him, he touched him, and he says, I will, be thou clean. Look at verse 42, praise the Lord, it will happen. When you show compassion, it will happen. The Lord will walk through your compassion. It will walk through your love. It will walk through your voice. It will walk through your tongue. It will walk through your touch. And miracles will happen in the lives of people in Jesus' name. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately, that's how your miracle is going to come. Immediately, somebody shout immediately. Immediately the leprosy departed from him and he was cleansed. Look at the value of that single soul in verse 45. Verse 45 says, but he went out, that leper is now cleansed. All he had to say is, look at me, I'm different now. All you have to say is, look at me, I'm different now. All you have to say is that Christ has taught me and a miracle has happened in my life. And he went out and began to publish it much and to blaze abroad the matter. Is so much that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but it was without in the desert. Look at this. And they came to him as a result of one single soul that he healed, one single soul that he touched, one single soul that is transformed. And they came to him, they came to Christ from every quarter. It will happen. Let's look at 1 John chapter 3 verse 17. 1 John chapter 3, we're reading from verse 17. It says, but whosoever hath this world's good and seeth his brother have need and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him. You have a lot of good things. You have knowledge, the knowledge of salvation, the knowledge of the gospel. You have the knowledge of the power of Christ, and you have the knowledge of eternal life, and you also have some material things. How is it that you say you have compassion? If we have compassion, we'll touch other people's lives, we'll introduce other people unto the goodness and the grace of God, and they will come to the Lord in Jesus' name. Let's look at number two here. Number two here is the confidence in the spotless Savior. The confidence in the spotless Savior. You see, Jesus Christ is the Savior, but is also spotless and sinless and blameless. He said, whosoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. Andrew believed that. Andrew, I expected that. I'm taking Peter, I'm taking Simon, my brother, unto Christ. And Andrew had confidence. When you bring people this year, you bring the sick, you must have confidence they'll be healed. You bring the lame, you must have confidence that Jesus Christ, the mighty Christ, and the mighty deliverer, and the mighty redeemer, you have confidence in this spotless Savior, they will be healed in Jesus' name. You bring anybody having mental problem, as you are coming on the way, bringing the person, you understand, you are not coming to meet the region overseer or the state overseer or whoever, you are coming to meet Christ there. And when the pastor there, when he mentions the name of Jesus, all those his infirmities will vanish away in Jesus' name. And look at John chapter 1 verse 42, and he brought him to Jesus. He had confidence in Christ, that Christ will touch him, and that Christ will remove all the doubt and all the sin. He'll make him a new creature. Look at chapter 6 of John, chapter 6 of John, verse 37. In verse 37, it tells us, John chapter 6, verse 37, all that the Father giveth me shall come unto me. All that the Father giveth me shall come unto me. You understand what that means? All those people, the Father has given them unto Christ, but they don't know that they are giving to Christ. Therefore, they are in that wilderness, they are on that street, they are in that community, and then you go to them. It's your appearance, it's your connection with them that will show that the Father has given them unto Christ, and they will come. And him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. That was the confidence of Andrew when he brought Simon unto Christ. That is your confidence, that as you bring them to Christ, one soul at a time, a single soul at a time, the Lord will not reject them. He will accept them. He will save them. What if I bring them and they are not saved? Didn't you hear the word of Christ? All that the Father has given unto me shall come unto me, and him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. As you are bringing people to Christ, believe, have the confidence in the unfailing Christ. They will be saved. Their lives will be turned around. As the Lord got hold of you, and the Lord has saved you, and the Lord has done the miracle of conversion in your life, it will be done in their lives in Jesus' name. John chapter 17 verse 2. In John chapter 17, looking at verse 2, it says, as thou hast given him power over all flesh. The Father has given Christ power over all flesh. Nobody will be too difficult that he will not subdue. And nobody will so receive the word of God that Christ will not convert, because the Father has given him all power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Let's look at number three here. Number three is conversion into steadfast sonship. Conversion into steadfast sonship. As we bring people to the Lord, we understand they repent, we understand they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put all that together, repentance for plus faith in Christ brings salvation. It brings conversion. And when they are converted, they may not look like they're stable, but the Lord Jesus Christ in John chapter 1 verse 42, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah, thou shalt be called Cephas, which by interpretation is stone. By interpretation, it is a stone. That means Peter was going to be stable, he was going to be solid, he was going to be steadfast. The Lord Jesus Christ looked at what Peter will be in the future. What Peter will be after salvation, what Peter will be after sanctification, what Peter will be after receiving the power of the Holy Ghost, what Peter will be, that Peter will be steadfast, you will be steadfast. That Peter will be solid, you will be solid. That Peter will be dependable, you will be dependable in Jesus' name. The Lord looks at every one of us, not as we are now. The Lord looks at every one of us, not according to our past history. He looks at us at what we shall be. You are going to be stable. And this is the Peter, he became a child of God. This is the Peter, he confessed the name of the Lord. This is the Peter that the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees and the Sadducees said, they didn't warn you, straightly commanded you that you should not speak in this name. And behold, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. And then Peter, stable and solid, not like a shifting stone, not like somebody is not sure, he said, we must obey God rather than men. And that same stability, solidity, the Lord will bring in your life in Jesus' name. Jesus said to them, will ye also go away? And Peter responded and replied, and he said, to whom shall we go? We are here, we are here. No wind will blow us away. No challenge will blow us away. No message will still disturb us that will run away from you, because you have the word of eternal life. He became solid and became steadfast. And that's what he has now told other people in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17. He said, the Lord touched me, and the Lord made me steadfast, and he made me solid. And I'm passing the same thing to you. Peter said, you too will be steadfast, and you'll be solid. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17, ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also be led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. Not only that he became steadfast, he became an encouragement to other people that they will be steadfast too. You will be steadfast in Jesus' name. We have seen point number one, which is seeking the lost one soul at a time. We're coming to point number two now. Point number two is sharing his love one step at a time. One step at a time. You remember the passage that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish but have everlasting love. That love is so deep, that love is so wide, that love is so high, and that love is so inexhaustible, deeper than any ocean, wider than any sea. But how are you going to share that love? I want you to look at, let's say a teacher, for example. A teacher has gone to primary, secondary, university, is even gone higher, but now he comes down to teach the students in JSS 1. These are children just coming out of the primary school. It's not going to offload on them all the knowledge he got from the university. It's going to be teaching them one subject at a time, one step at a time, one idea at a time, a part of what he knows, a little at a time, enough to wake that child up, enough for that child to learn something new, and then to move on. The same thing, we have known the love of God, and we want to share that love, and we're doing that one step at a time. Remember, when you are talking to somebody, your neighbor, somebody in your world, your mother, your father, or your child, or any friend, you are talking to them one soul at a time. Remember, you're not going to tell them everything you know about the love of God. You're going to tell them of the love of God for that moment, one step at a time. We're looking at three things here. Number one, confirm your love by following Christ. If you're going to, you cannot tell what you have not received. You cannot share what you don't have. If you're going to share the love of Christ, you yourself must have tasted of that love of Christ. Confirm your own love by following Christ. Number two, calling another lovingly. Calling another lovingly to follow Christ. There's a way you can call somebody and the person will feel insulted. There's a way you can call somebody and the person will be fearful. There's a way you can call somebody and say come. There's a way you can pronounce that come that the fellow will say, I don't know what he's going to do to me. I don't know what is going to make of me if I really go. But you call them lovingly. When somebody calls you and when somebody called you to receive the gospel, you felt the love. There's something good waiting for me and there's something good I'm going to receive. That's why you came. If when they called you, they pumped fear into you and they pumped panic into you and they say come with a tone that says you will see, I will deal with you, come. You see, that come will not bring them. Number two here, you are calling another one lovingly to follow Christ. Number three, you continue to love and to follow Christ. Let's look at number one. Number one, confirm your love by following Christ. In John chapter 1 verse 43. John chapter 1 verse 43. The day following, Jesus will go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip and saith unto him, follow me. He himself, Christ, found Philip. If Christ, so high, so big, and eternal, could spend time and look around. When you walk around, don't be looking down. Look at the faces of people. You'll see people that hurt. You'll see people who are expectant. You'll see people who are suffering. Look up and see people as they're going to interact with people, touch people's life. And Jesus Christ looked at Philip and he said, follow me. Look at verse 44. In verse 44, now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And the Lord called him. He said, follow me. And Philip followed the Lord. Like you have followed the Lord, you have taken the first step following the Lord. You're still to take other steps. And as you follow the Lord, you become more intimate with him. And what you have not seen yet, you will see in Jesus' name. But as we talk about following the Lord is not here in the physical that will say, okay, here is that Christ. And then I'm walking following him. Look at what it means in verse 11 of chapter 8. John chapter 8, reading from verse 11. She saith, no man, Lord. The Lord has asked a question. As no man condemned you, he said, no man, Lord. As you get up and you are following Christ, all condemnation of the past will be wiped out in your life. The condemnation of Pharisees, we caught him, we saw him, he did nothing. We saw her, she did nothing. All that condemnation will vanish away in Jesus' name. As no man on earth, no religious man, and no investigative man had been able to condemn you, he said, no man, Lord. Once the Lord Jesus Christ does not condemn you, no other condemnation can take effect in your life in Jesus' name. When Jesus said, I forgive you, I wipe away your sin, no condemnation now to those who are walking in the spirit and not after the flesh, you are no more condemned in Jesus' name. Even Satan cannot condemn you. Your old classmates cannot condemn you. Your old partners in sin cannot condemn you anymore. You are forgiven. You are set free. Your name is written in the book of life in heaven. No man condemns you in Jesus' name. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee, go and sin no more. You must understand that the words of Christ always carried power. when a blind man came and Jesus said, what do you want? He said that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said, receive your sight. And power went with that word. He received his sight. Somebody's hand was withered. And Jesus said, stretch forth your hand. Power went with that word. He stretched out the hand. And then somebody was a leper. And he said, you are cleaner. And the cleansing came immediately. When Jesus said to this woman, as he has said unto you, as he's saying to you, go and sin no more, power will enter into your life. The ability and the strength to live victorious now, the victory you never knew before, you will know in Jesus' name. Now look at verse 12 and look at the significance of following Christ and what it means to follow Christ. It says, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me, look at that, he that followeth me, what's the result? What's the implication? What's the consequence? He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness. All the powers of darkness, they are gone in Jesus' name. If you belong to a cult before, once you rise up and you are following Christ, you will abandon that cult. You are no more walking in darkness. If you are in a secret cult and you are doing some covenant in darkness there, once you are following Christ, all that will vanish away. He that followeth Christ shall not walk in darkness. If you are in a secret covenant, a secret agreement with anybody, and you are conspiring against any life in darkness, we will do this, we'll do that. Once you come to Christ, all that controversy and all that sin that you are planning in darkness, everything will vanish away. You are now a man of light, a woman of light, and you are following the light of the world, and the light will shine forth through your life in Jesus' name. It says, he shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. That's what it means to follow the Lord. And as you are following the Lord, you will not follow any strange voice in Jesus' name. Look at John chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. John chapter 10, we're reading from verse 4. It says, and when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him. If you have been born again, that's what you are doing. Anything you want to do, anywhere, anytime, you will ask yourself, if Jesus were in this situation, in this new year, in the physical, what will Christ do? And what Christ will do, that is what you'll do. Well, how will Christ speak? That's how you will speak. How will Christ act? That's the way you will act. How will Christ touch other lives? That's the way you'll touch other life. Will Christ frown? Will Christ get angry? Will Christ fight? Will Christ be drunk? Whatever Christ will do, that is what you will do. Even though he was persecuted, even though he was misunderstood, we never heard an angry word out of his mouth. The same thing now, he that followeth me will not follow anything that is evil. They shall, and they know his voice. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, and a stranger will they not follow. You will not follow a stranger. Yeah. And you will not follow a false prophet. You'll not follow, they might, put it on the internet, their prophecy, and then the very strange things that they are saying, or they might put it in the papers, or they might send a neighbor to you. Instead of you evangelizing them for Christ, they want to evangelize you for Satan. Nobody will succeed evangelizing you for Satan in Jesus' name. A stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. The grace to follow and the joy to follow Christ intimately without ever looking back, the Lord grant unto every one of us this year in Jesus' name. Look at number two here. Number two is calling another lovingly to follow Christ. calling another lovingly to follow Christ. I want to ask you, there are some of us, we got married before we were born again, and now you are born again. Maybe you are the husband, you are born again, and your wife is wondering, what's born again, what is it all about? And then you are going to church and you are calling your wife. How do you call your wife to come to church with you? If you speak in a loving language, if you speak in a persuasive language, she would say, my husband respects me now, she loves me now, she wants the best for me. You must call her lovingly to follow Christ. Or maybe you are the wife, you are the one that is born again, but your husband, maybe he's drinking, maybe he is having some other peculiarities, and he's carrying this and carrying that, and you discover a lot of things in his life. If you get angry and then you say, this is what I've been telling you, come to Christ, the way you call him, if you are calling him with anger, if you are calling him retaliation, all that, he will not follow like that. But when you forgive him, when you forget what he has done, and you look at him lovingly, and you take care of him lovingly, and then you call him lovingly to follow the same Christ, he doesn't know the value of Christ yet, but he knows you, and he knows you are a changed woman now, he will follow and he'll be converted in Jesus' name. You have your children are in your world, they're in the world of your relationship, and but you know, those children, they're growing up now, and the way they're growing up, they've gone to college and they have joined this and joined that, and you have seen the result on them. You see the way they make their ear deal, and you see the kind of dress they wear. Already you're angry. If you're angry, you say, my boy, of all people, how can he be like this? And then you are calling him, this coming Sunday we're going to church. Now if you call your child in an angry way, he'll not be persuaded. He will want to show, I'm no more a three-year-old boy you are talking to the other time, and then you take the whip. If you want to beat me, here am I, and stretches out his hand, beat me, okay, I'm ready. You see, you cannot win your children in that way. All your siblings, your junior brother, your junior sister, and the people that are close to you, you must find something they love, something they appreciate, and you must touch them at that point of love, and you are calling them lovingly to follow Christ. Let's look at John chapter 1. We're looking at verse 45. And Philip findeth Nathanael and saith unto him, we found him of whom Moses in the law and in the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And then we're told in verse 46, look at verse 46, here is what Nathanael said. And Nathanael said unto him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? How do you understand that? He's talking about Jesus, and Philip had said that Jesus from Nazareth, we found him, and look at the language he's responding with. How will you feel if anybody spoke like that about where your savior has come, or even your local pastor? You love your local pastor, you respect your local pastor, and then you are calling somebody, let's come to church, we're going to hear about Jesus, something wonderful is going to take place. And he says, so is that your pastor? And then you mention his name, he says from where, and then you mention the place he came from, and he says, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Don't lose your love, don't lose your cool, don't lose your temperament, and don't lose anything. The virtue of Christ in you will abide in Jesus' name. Whatever they say that in their ignorance, that will not cancel your love. You still invite them and you call them lovingly to follow Christ. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, reading from verse 29. Acts chapter 8, reading from verse 29. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. Now this man, the eunuch of Ethiopia, was a total stranger to Philip. And this another Philip now, and this Philip, the Spirit of God said, go join thyself to this chariot. The Spirit of God knows the end from the beginning. It's a stranger you've never met, and the Spirit of God is linking you together and is getting you to him. Go near and join yourself to this chariot. Whatever the Spirit of God says, something good will come out of it. Don't say, but I don't know him, I've never met him, but who is this person? How can I talk to a total stranger? The Spirit of God said unto Philip, go near. And if you're going to invite people, you must get near. If you're at a distance and you're always keeping your distance, as if you're going to the market, will take holiness away from you, and you're interacting with people will take holiness from you, and you're speaking your vernacular, your local language, that man, that woman understands, as he's speaking your local language will take a holiness away from you. If you act in a way as if I cannot get near, it's a stranger, it's a stranger to the grace of God, it's a stranger to salvation, it's a stranger to me. And even the way she dresses, even the way he is appearing, is a total stranger. If we're like that, and we're keeping, you're not only keeping social distancing, you know, you're keeping spiritual distancing, salvation distancing, everything, you know, you keep away from people, are you going to bring them to the Lord? Lovingly, you will get near, and the Spirit of God that said, go near this chariot and join thyself to this chariot, it will walk on that eunuch of Ethiopia. Look at verse 30. In verse 30, it says, and Philip ran thither to him. That's the excitement of the new year, and that is the joy of the new year. The Spirit of God has spoken to me like he never spoke before. I've never done this, I've never been in a desert to join myself to a chariot, but the Spirit has spoken. I'm so happy the Spirit of God has spoken to me. And then excitedly I take that up, and Philip ran to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, understandest thou what thou readest? No insult, no abusive language, no belittling him. Just said, I see you're reading Isaiah. Do you understand what you read? Know the question to ask people, the question that will link them up with you, the question that will attract you to them, and the question that will make them respond to you, and the question that will make them to say, I want something that you have, I want to have explanation, I want to get this. And then in verse 31, we're told, and he said, how can I except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip. You must be a desirable brother, a desirable sister. The way you talk, the way you comport yourself, and the way you look at people, and with a smile on your face, and with an attitude, I want to be of help. I abandon all that I'm doing in Samaria, and you are the important personality. You are the most important person now. Because of that, I concentrate, and because of that, I want the very best for you in this new year. You can tell a lot by the way you relate with people that they desire you. You'll be desirable in Jesus' name. You're not always speaking the same language that you have spoken, and you're not approaching people. I don't know whether this one is like Simon that I met in Samaria, who bewitched the people. You're not suspecting people, it's a total stranger. You're not looking at your past experiences to deal with the people you're meeting for the first time. And because Philip was a transformed person, a changed person, like you, like me, in this new year, things are going to happen that will become miraculous conversions in Jesus' name. him, and he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. And then in verse 32 it says, the place of the scripture which he read was this: he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before a shearer, so he opened not his mouth. And then verse 33, the eunuch in his humiliation, his judgments was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And then in verse 34 it says, and the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speakest the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Look at what had happened here. The eunuch had never met Philip. Philip had never met the eunuch. And now this stranger, they were strange to each other, but the eunuch now had confidence in him. Can you have confidence in somebody you're just meeting for the first time? The way Philip asked the question, the way Philip comported himself, and the way Philip opened up everything, the eunuch now believed that Philip had the answer. And people you contact and people you relate with, the way you relate with them will make them know that you have the answer. You have the answer. Answer to their problem, you have their answer. Solution to their headache, you have the solution. And so confidently now the eunuch asked, who is this one? Is this writing about himself or some other man? In verse 35, we're told, then Philip opened his mouth. Then Philip opened his mouth. There are people, they are talking to somebody very near, and when they are talking, they eat their words, they swallow their words, they do not open their mouth to talk clearly. And the person you are talking to say, pardon me, what did you say? I didn't catch that word. Then you repeat it, and then after two sentences, what is that? What did you say? If you are going to relate with people, you must relate with them like you are talking to a familiar person, your child, your son, your daughter, your friend, the people you are comfortable with. You are not afraid. It's fear that makes people to speak in a way you can't understand them. They are not clear in what they are passing across. As you meet somebody, he has never met you. If you rush what you are saying, he may not understand. If you talk jargon, he may not understand. If you use vocabularies that, you know, is strange to the strange person, he cannot understand. Now, what's the purpose of talking to that person? Is it to show you have been to university? Is it to show that you carry dictionary inside you? Is it to show that you know the jaw-breaking words of the English language? That's not your purpose. If you want to win somebody, you must talk in a way that the fellow will understand. And so Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture. He began at the same scripture. The thing that the eunuch was reading about, he began there. You go from known to the unknown. Already the man knows the book of Isaiah, and the man already knows that this is part of the Bible, and the man knows that this is a prophet, and God is speaking through that prophet of the Bible. And so the eunuch now heard that this person that you know already, and this book you are reading already, this is the interpretation. And he preached unto him Jesus. Whatever your topic, you must end up talking about Jesus. Is our Savior, is our Redeemer, is our Healer. Whatever you are talking about, and whichever scripture you are, in Genesis or in Isaiah, or you are in Psalms, or the fellow is asking question about a place in Revelation, you start there, and you must end up talking about Jesus, because you understand it is not Isaiah that will save them, and it is not Matthew that will save them. It is what has been written about Christ. You expand that, you expound it, and you explain it, and that will lead them to Jesus. They'll be born again, they'll be saved in Jesus' name. You will have converts this year. And then, as you read the whole story, Philip said, the man said, here is water, what hinders me to be baptized? And Philip said, if you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is the Savior, he said, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And then he was baptized, and the joy of salvation came to him, and he went his way, now having eternal life and salvation. Before you part from those people you are contacting, you are touching, eternal life will come to them in Jesus' name. Look at number three now. Number three of that section, continue to love and to follow Christ. Continue to love and to follow Christ. As you have started loving Christ, you must show that love and you must continue. I want to remind you of the time, if you are married, you just knew the will of God, and this sister now has said yes, or that brother has said yes, you are to go for courtship, maybe in a church building, maybe in the house, in the apartment of your group pastor, or whoever, a matured person. And then before you came out, look at the cloud, it's looking like it's going to rain, and look at the hold up is so much, how can I go through this? But you are so much in love with this sister, with this brother who has said yes, that hold up will not keep you back. Rain will not keep you back. Sunshine will not keep you back. And the climate is hot now, and I'm sweating, that will not keep you back. The same thing with the love of Christ in your heart. Whatever is happening, they say there's pandemic, that pandemic is not for you. And they say there is hold up, the hold up is not for you. You are so much in love with the Lord Jesus Christ, you continue in his love. Every time you want to pray to him, every time you want to interact with him, every time you want to show that Jesus Christ is the number one love in your life, look at John chapter 15, and we're reading from verse 8. John chapter 15 verse 8, herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. This year you'll bear much fruit. Amen. Okay, I say for myself, I will bear much fruit. You'll bear fruit in Jesus' name. Amen. In your marriage, you'll bear fruit. Amen. In your family, you'll bear fruit. Amen. In soul winning, you'll bear fruit. And in your Christian life, you'll bear fruit. In the work of your heart, in your profession, you'll bear fruit in Jesus' name. This year for you will be better than the previous years. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. But look at verse 9. Verse 9 says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Does Jesus love you? Yes. I said, does Jesus love you? Yes. He loves you enough to have saved you. He loves you enough to heal you. He loves you enough to answer your prayer. His love will never fail in your life in Jesus' name. Yes. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Continue ye in my love. I will continue. You will continue. Nothing will separate us, nothing will separate you from the love of Christ in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number three now. In point number three, we're showing forth his life, one statement at a time. We're showing forth his life, one statement at a time. Look at John chapter 1 verse 46. In John chapter 1 verse 46, Nathanael said unto him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Maybe somebody is saying, I know what my life has been, can anything good come out of my life? You have an answer. He says, this year, even you remember, even January 1st, do you know what happened? And he tells you, and then you are inviting him to Christ, and you are saying something good, something great, something marvelous is going to happen. And they say, can anything good come out of this year? And or maybe you say, where are you from? They say, I'm from such and such a place. Come, something good is going to come. And they're telling you history, and they're saying, you know, our village, our town, nothing good has ever come. I remember so and so and so and so and such, as they want to get up like this, then something will disorganize everything. It happened to my senior brother, it happened to my uncle, it happened to my cousin. I'm even feeling the symptoms now. Can anything good come out of our family? There's only one answer. Philip saith unto him, tell me the answer. Come and see. And I invite you this year, come and see. Come and see the Lord. Come and see his light. And come and see the miracle. Come and see his power. You will see this year in Jesus' name. And don't prolong it. Don't prolong it. Just a short sentence, because you are showing forth his life, one statement, one sentence at a time. Three things. Number one, come and see. That's all. Come and see. When you say that with confidence. Come and see. When you say that with faith. Come and see. When you say that with assurance. Come and see. You yourself, you'll see the goodness of the Lord in Jesus' name. Number two, care and share. Care and share. As you look at people, what shows that you care? Because you share. Because you share. You care. You share. And then number three, cleave and serve. You cleave to the Lord and you keep on serving. Let's look at number one, come and see. We're looking at that John chapter 1 verse 46 again. It says, Nathanael said unto him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Don't argue. Argument does not win people. Argument may win a point, like in a debate. Don't debate with people. All you are saying is, if they can only come to Christ, Christ will change their lives positively, practically, and permanently in Jesus' name. So there's no argument. Come and see. And I'm not arguing with you also. I'm telling you that this year, something greater than you ever saw will happen in your life in Jesus' name. And if you are wondering there, but look at this pastor, look at this pastor, all I can tell you is come and see. If you come, you will see. And so Philip said, come and see. Look at Psalm 66. In Psalm 66, we're looking at verse 6. Psalm 66, we're looking at verse 6. In verse 6, it says, he turned the sea into dry land. They went through the flood on foot, and there did we rejoice in him. In verse 7 it says, he ruleth by his power forever. His eyes behold the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. And now in verse 8 it says, oh, bless the Lord, ye his people, and make the voice of his praise, let it be heard. And now in verse 5 it tells us, come and see the works of God. In this new year, I'm inviting you, come and see the salvation of God. Come and see the power of God. Come and see the fulfillment of the promises of God. Come and see the works of God. He is terrible in his doing towards the children of men. You will see. I will see. I will see. You know, when the Queen of Sheba was invited to come to Solomon, She didn't know that she'll see any marvelous scene. And eventually she came, and when she came and she saw, she said, half of it was not told. When I was told in my country to come and see, I didn't know about your men, about your servants, about the goodness, about your glory, about the splendor. I have come, I have seen. And as I'm telling you, at the beginning of this new year, come and see. You have not seen anything yet. Miracles upon miracles, power, manifestation, and the glory of God. Come and see. You will say like that queen of Sheba, half of it was not told me. I have come, I have seen. You will come, you will see in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 52 verse 10. In Isaiah chapter 52, we're looking at verse 10. The Lord has made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth, all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. All, everyone, are you there? Will you see? Where are you? Be it unto you according to your faith in Jesus. Number two now. Number two is to care and share. Care and share. We're coming back to John chapter 1, verse 45 and verse 46. John chapter 1, verse 45. Philip findeth Nathanael. Remember, you must find a neighbor. You must find somebody in your world. You must find a relative. You must find a brother, a sister, junior or senior. You must find a classmate. You must find an acquaintance. You must find somebody, as Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, we found him of whom Moses in the law and in the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And then in verse 46, it says, and Nathanael said unto him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? And Philip said unto him, what you are going to say unto that brother, to that sister, what are you going to say? Come and see. And as you tell them, you tell them because you care. You care for them. Look at him. He's sick. He has spent a lot of money and yet he's not getting better. You care. You share about the one who can give them divine healing. Look at their child. He's tormented by evil spirit and they have tried. They've gone here. They've gone there. Don't condemn them for where they have gone. They have gone to herbalists. Don't condemn them. They have gone to seek help and here and there. Remember, you must call them lovingly, and then you share with them. You say, I know what you've done. I know what all the efforts you have taken, but I'm calling you. This is going to be the last bus stop. You are going to get your miracle. And you say that assuredly because you care. You care and you share, and God will make you a caring person in Jesus' name. And what to share with them, the Lord will confirm in Jesus' name. Look at Psalm 66. We're reading from verse 16. In Psalm 66, reading from verse 16, is telling about the care you have. You say, come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare what he has done for my soul. You care enough to share your testimony. He saved me. You were a drunkard, or you were this and that, and then you tell them, look at the power of God and the salvation of the Lord. Come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare, I will tell you what he has done for my soul. You were sick, you almost left for dead, but the Lord touched you and you are healed. You are telling them, you care enough to share your testimony. Come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare what he has done for my soul. You had a particular peculiarity in your character that made you odious, that made you stink before people, and nobody wanted to come near you, and they didn't want to be close to you because they knew if they came near you, here is what will splash on them. But the Lord Jesus has taken your life. Everything is turned around now, and you are a better person, in Jesus' name, you're a better person. And all your bitterness have been turned to sweetness, and now your life is sweet. Lord, your language is sweet, your appearance is sweet, and people need, they want to come near you now. You want to tell them how that has happened because you care enough to share. Come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare what he has done for my soul. You will have enough to share. Testimonies upon testimonies, you will have enough to share, because your life is going to become better, your life is going to become brighter, and your life will be bigger even around in your community, in Jesus' name. You will share because you care. Am I talking to somebody there today? You'll share, and what you share will attract them to the Lord, in Jesus' name. Number three is to cleave and to serve. To cleave and to serve. That word cleave means you join together so intimately with somebody. You are joined to that sick person. Is not responding, but you cleave to them because you cleave to the Lord. And that person that's having this challenge, he said some negative things about our church, and because of that, he never even found it, tried to find out how positive, how real is this, and he has made up his mind, anytime you mention that church, I'm not going to give attention to them, because I hear they've done this, I hear they have done that. And all those things are total lies, but you don't allow that to put you off. You cleave and you serve, and the Lord will make use of your life as you cleave to them, as you love them, as you keep on inviting them, in Jesus' name. And look at this, John chapter 1, reading from verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him. You understand that? Philip did not say, you've said, can anything good come out of now? Okay, go your way. He was cleaving to him. He stayed with him until he brought him. We're talking about friendship, evangelism. Don't just contact them and drop them. We're talking about neighborhood evangelism. Don't just contact them and drop them. We're talking about media evangelism. Don't just try one thing and then it's not even a result and then you give up. You cleave until they respond. They're going to respond in Jesus' name. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and says unto him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Verse 48, and Nathanael saith unto him, from whence knowest thou me? Understand what Philip said has started being fulfilled. Come and see. Come and see somebody who knows you before you know him. Come and see somebody who has all knowledge about everybody. He knows about your problem even before you tell him, and he's going to bring solution to your life. And come and see. And now Nathanael saith unto him, from whence thou knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said, before that Philip called thee, when thou was under the fig tree, I saw thee. Look at this, exactly what Philip had said. Come and see. You've never seen anybody like this before. He knows your past, he knows your present, and he knows what you're going to become in future. He's going to make a star out of you. He's going to make success out of you. He's going to make a progressive person out of you. He's going to turn your life around. All you have to do is come and see. And then look at verse 49. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, he called him Rabbi now. He forgot what he said before. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? They will forget all the rubbish they have said in the past. Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel. And look at verse verse 50 says, Jesus answered and said unto him, because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? He was now a believer. Everyone like Nathaniel, that you like Philip brings to the Lord, they will believe on the Lord in Jesus' name. They'll believe and have salvation. They'll believe and have healing. They'll believe and have deliverance. They'll believe and they'll make progress in their lives in Jesus' name. And Jesus said, thou shalt see greater things than this. Thou shalt see greater things than this. I'm just a mouthpiece of the Lord. And this is what the Lord is telling you through this channel, that this year you'll see greater things than this. Greater miracles than this, greater power than this, greater progress than this, greater breakthrough than this. All the miracles you have seen before, all the breakthroughs you've seen before, add everything together, bundle everything together. The Lord is telling you through this channel tonight, you'll see greater things than those miracles in Jesus' name. Your life will be unbelievably spotless and glorious in Jesus' name. What you never dreamt of, what you never thought of the great blessings of the Lord, as you cleave to the Lord and as you are serving the Lord, you will see in Jesus' name. And in verse 51, and he saith unto him, verily, verily, truly, truly, assuredly, assuredly, I say unto you, hereafter, as you remain with the Lord hereafter, as you cleave to the Lord hereafter, ye shall see heaven opened. Look at what Philip told him, come and see. And the Lord is confirming that everything Philip had told you, come and see, you'll see. You have seen now, I know your life. You have seen now, I say you are a man of no guile. I take every guilt away from your life. I give you conversion. I give you salvation. You've seen that now. You are going to see greater things. You see sanctification, you are going to see greater things. You see Holy Ghost baptism, you are going to see greater things. You see fruitfulness in Jesus' name. And hereafter, ye shall see heaven opened. Heaven will be opened unto you. That the rains come down, blessings will come down upon your life, and you'll see the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Wipe away your tears. Don't let tears becloud your eyes, because this year is a year of seeing. Amen. Come and see. Come and see. Come and see. Where are you? If you're ready to see, why don't you stand up and say, Lord, I'm ready. You will see this year. Power, you'll see this year. Miracle, you'll see this year. Things you've never seen in your life before, this year is the year of breakthrough. You'll break through and you'll break forth in soul winning. Come and see. Care and share. Cleave and serve. Serve the Lord this year, and things you have never seen, everything you have prayed for, everything you are praying for, you will see a fulfillment, a solution, an answer will come in your life. Expect a miracle every day. It will happen.